and welcome to New Mexico's Naturopathic Medical Show. I'm Dr. Wendy Van Dilla, Doctor of Naturopathic Medicine. In the studio today with me is my dear friend Bill O'Donnell. Thank you for coming on again, Bill.
My pleasure, Wendy, my dear protege.
Bill got me into this community TV producing and hosting, and you all who are watching and subscribing on YouTube are getting the benefits of what he got me into in the first place.
It's the greatest show. I'm not kidding. It's better than my show, I think. I'm almost...
What is your show?
I have Spirituality TV I've been doing for over 20 years, but in some ways I really think your show is more important in that sense because it helps people learn and take the important steps within your body. And here are the practitioners you bring in. When someone needs some help or some guidance, you bring them on. So I couldn't be prouder of you.
Thank you, Bill.
And to be
so I want to take advantage of you being in on the guest right now. And you learned naturopathy from an apprentice style way of learning naturopathic medicine. Tell us how you were raised by an AMA physician, your father. And how did you get interested in other types of medicine?
Well, this is so really coming of age in the 50s and 60s. So my dad was a doctor. He was a general practitioner and surgeon in a small town in the San Francisco Bay Area. He had been a Navy doctor during World War II. He served on the destroyer of the USS Hadley.
In the Pacific?
In the Pacific. And he was fresh, you know, out of medical school and residency at Mare Island Naval Shipyard in the San Francisco Bay Area. And his father was the master boilermaker, my grandfather, at the Mare Island. And so he went in harm's way. It was a great movie, I think Otto Preminger did, and called In Harm's Way, and talked about the flotilla that headed for Okinawa, the Battle of Okinawa, one of the last great battles of World War II. And they were there on picket duty, the Hadley and the Evans. And when they were attacked by kamikazes, you know, for the longest time, there's footage on it, a show called Battle Line, you can see it. And anyhow, they eventually had to abandon ship. And I read this in a magazine where young Dr. B.B. O'Donnell had to go back down to his stateroom to get supplies to abandon ship. There was the hole in the ship, and the dead Japanese pilot was sprawled half on his bed.
Oh, my God.
I know.
Oh,
I know.
Wow.
Stories like that. And I got to go with him. And the survivors of that, they lost about a third of their men, 300 men or something. And I went to some of their reunions before he passed away.
Wow.
And it was very interesting to see and hear these guys who had been in harm's way, raised in the Depression and then go off to World War II. Different generations. So when he came back to practice medicine, I learned from him. And mother later worked in the office. So at home, there were samples of vitamins and stuff. Oh, what's this? You know, kind of a thing.
Mm-hmm.
And so we did it on our own, really. I learned what happens if you take too many, you know, you get a headache or something, and these were a lot of chemical stuff. And I later, hey, what's better? You know, kind of a thing. And then I went from his samples to, I think it was Shackley, to Wachter's products, and then eventually to blue-green algae. And so I just started learning kind of on my own and with him.
But what was your motivation?
Motivation?
I mean, most times people go to doctors because they're sick.
I know. Well, I lived with one. So if you were sick, if you had a temperature over 101, you were going to get an intramuscular shot of penicillin. Unfortunately, now I'm allergic to penicillin. They stopped doing that. They learn. It's a practice of medicine. It's not a science. You know. So
right.
So that's where it got. That's where I got started. And then I wanted later when I went off to
but
graduate.
But you got
school,
interested in health.
Well, later went off to graduate school. I want to give credit to the late, what was her name? I'm sorry, to come. It was a health food store in Sacramento where I was going to graduate school, and I just wandered in there, and her name will come to me. And I was looking at the product. She came over to help me, and I looked at the prices. You know, I can't afford to buy things in your store. And she looked at me just straight on and says, You can't afford not to. And I heard it. Just went, like, bounced off the back of my head and came back out. Georgiana Elliott in Elliott's Natural Foods. Her sons and her husband, Walker, and her children, you know, still have those in Sacramento. One's on El Camino, I think, and the other. And so I came under her tutelage in that area. At the same time, I was in law school at the time, studying to be a lawyer. And she got arrested for practicing medicine without a license, just talking about her products.
Right.
And that was a great education because, and thank God we were in California at the time and Governor Jerry Brown was there then even, and they later changed things in the state of California in the health and safety code section, which right. regulated the practice of medicine to give an exclusion that people in health food stores could talk about their products without violating that practice of medicine statute. And but it was truly overbroad and over-inclusive because, you know, you see an ad on TV, oh, take this aspirin for a headache. That was practicing medicine,
yes.
too. So it allowed a little more flexibility in there, and that's a whole other story.
So you got interested in blue-green algae at one point.
I did. I forget exactly who turned me on to that, but I think we'll have to give credit to my friend David of the San Francisco Medical Research Group.
Mm-hmm.
And he was the first person I read in print that actually, they call it spirulina, the domestic variety of it. In other words, that's which is grown domestically. Now I get my wildcrafted from Klamath mm-hmm. Lake from you,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
From various companies. And for a time there, I was a distributor for Celtec because it was the best way to get the...
You have a real developed sensitivity. What do you sense when you take blue-green algae?
Well, I don't go anywhere now without it because if I start to feel a little tired or a little diminished, I'll tell you my story because I'm also a ski instructor now, but then I was just mm-hmm. a skier and I had overdone it and it's like 3 o'clock and I've been going all day and I get off the top of the chair at Ski Santa Fe where I'm instructor now and my legs were shaking. I go, oh no, I've overdone it again. What do I do? And I remember that I had a couple of these caps, quarter gram of blue-green algae from Klamath Lake in my pocket. So I took some snow, put it in my mouth, and opened one of these caps into my mouth, and a miracle happened. And all you skiers will, you know, and snowboarders will know what I'm talking about. Within seconds, within no more than 2 minutes, that algae was absorbed into my bloodstream from my mouth.
Oh, yeah.
And all of a sudden, my legs weren't tired anymore. You can't do that. You couldn't take a stimulant and get that response. And it's really great when you're deficient. And also, so I skied down and got back on the chair and rode back up again and skied down again.
Well, the mouth is an... You can absorb many things through your mouth and it goes right into your bloodstream. You don't have to digest it.
Yeah, I know.
So that's what you were experiencing.
And then I did it again. I did the same. And then I never forgot it because that's a revelation. That's an eye-opening revelation that there's food out there on the planet that can really help you. So
mm-hmm.
it's something that I keep with
That's
me
excellent.
All the time.
So another thing that you do all the time is testing out to see if some substance is beneficial or not for you right now.
Mm-hmm. Well, they call it muscle testing, or it's an applied kinesiology test
uh-huh.
that I was exposed to at first, primarily by chiropractors and other naturopaths mm-hmm. who would routinely do this in terms of testing you in their office. I mean, for years, usually the leg, you know, my
or
friend Dr.
Arm.
Vito, yeah, and or the, then they do the arm and stuff, and that tire you out in a hurry. But it was my friend. It was my friend Dr. Robert March, who was a naturopath and trained with the late Dr. Scherer as I did, and he taught me this one: yes or no, yes.
So what
or
do you? What
weaken.
Are you doing?
You're just asking.
Describe it.
You're just asking.
You're asking: is this
it, yeah.
substance?
Was this gonna? And my friend Dr. Ron Henry, a naturopathic chiropractor in Boulder, and he says, basically, look, every substance you put in your body is only going to do one of three things. It's either going to strengthen you, be neutral,
or
weaken you. And we learned that even with water. And this came, you know, in the whole area of, it was a wonderful water called Trinity Water Company out of Idaho. And that's when the context came up. You have to have water. And you're better off with some water, even if it's not that great, or neutral.
So if you were going to test your water, mm-hmm. how would you test your water?
Well, now
I
can just put it in my hand, and
your
my left hand, typically. And if you want it, your body will squeeze it. Allow yourself just, you know, squeeze it. If it doesn't want it, it won't want to squeeze it.
Okay.
And
so
you can do that with other substances.
So how about the...
Well, I'm motivated from there, because now I can literally do on a menu. In a restaurant, I'll put my left hand, yes or no, or, you know, and that will help me decide on what you're going to eat. What does your body need? What are you deficient in at that time? I'm going to do the same thing in the morning when I'm taking supplements, yes or no. Is this one or two strengthening, just a way. And you teach this yourself. You learn from yourself on how to integrate these things over time. And when you get a chance, if you can share it with someone, go ahead, because it'll make us all better in the long run.
Well, do you think anyone can do that, or are you just particularly?
I mean, if I could do it.
But
No, seriously, you have to try. It's not, first of all, don't come at it with your rational mind. You've got to give your rational mind a break. Don't live only with your rational mind. You have to go with your intuition, you have to develop your sensitivity, and you have to, you know, let your imagination activate within you. And to understand, I mean, you like a color over another color, don't you? Mm-hmm. Or, you know, you're attracted to some people or not, you know, kind of thing. There's a lot going on that you already have. Work with it. Find someone to help you and practice.
What you're saying is very revolutionary, because we've developed a culture where we go to the experts to tell us about our bodies and about our minds. And you're saying that knowledge is within you.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. And I learned in the legal practice, how do you become an expert? Well, you work in the field for about 6 months, and you know more than the other guy or whatever. I'll never forget the first time I was doing a project for a law professor, and he says, now you know more than I do, because I'd done research. Ah. You know. So we all can learn, and there are great books out there to start. You know. So don't denigrate your rational mind. Use it. Use it to learn all you can. But ultimately, you have to create that sensitivity and desire to discern what's
well,
best for you.
Another thing I learned about muscle testing is you have to be detached from the results.
Oh, yeah.
You can't decide, yeah. Oh, well, I need that,
yeah,
and
don't,
I'm going to
yeah.
muscle test.
That's an excellent point. Remember that. You've got to tell your rational mind just to hush, watch what's going on, but don't get too involved. You have the final word, but don't get too involved.
Well, to me, that's what meditation is all about,
Absolutely.
Is training your rational mind to hush and just be quiet for a while and let something else come in. Which also, would you tell us, at the break we were talking about the, was it the first commandment? The love with your...
Oh, the highest commandment.
Highest commandment.
There's the Ten Commandments, and you can see that, I think it's in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 5, but in chapter 6, verse 4 through 10, it's the highest commandment, which is to love with your whole heart, love with your whole soul, and love with your whole mind.
In
that order.
So heart first.
Heart, soul.
Soul, and mind. Then mind.
Yeah. Somebody told me this story as an analogy. Your heart is like the boat that you're in. And your soul is like the sail. Hmm. And your mind is like you at the tiller. And so you're going across a lake. What happens? Seas get rough, or they're calm, and the wind is blowing, and you've got a tack. You've got to tack that boat, and that's where because you don't know where the wind is blowing, but you have to learn how to tack. And that's kind of the analogy. And so when you're at the tiller and you're listening to your heart, your boat, and your soul, your sail, you're in the right place. But if your mind is out front and you don't know where your heart and your soul is, guess what? You're in trouble.
Yep,
you know,
trouble.
You don't know where you are. You don't know who you are. Your mind wants to take over. But if your mind is serving the heart and soul, then you're in the right position. And that's what I've extrapolated from the highest commandment. It's in that order for a reason.
Well, there's so much overlap between eating well and taking care of yourself and how you treat your mind and where what your spirituality is. I think in modern medicine, we're really missing out on that connection, that people are shoved into mental institutions or they're drugged in the hospital, and there's no good crossover to help take care of the mind and the body until you get to holistic medicine.
You're right. I couldn't have said it better. It's something very important. It's like we're all under stress, you know, and we have to learn how to handle it. Meditation, contemplation, reflection, those are all good things to do to step back and take some time. It's also when you take a shower, you're having a negative ion immersion. You're literally washing away the gunk that comes with those other ions. The positively charged ions are the ones that kind of screw you up. And I think I read that first in a Seventh-day Adventist booklet about the work that the Israelis had done in the desert. They knew that that hot wind and the dust and that sort of thing created positively charged ions, which will affect you negatively. Whereas a shower or being by the seashore, going swimming in water, is a negative immersion.
And
that's why they make negative ionizers and those things, to be careful, you know, in how to treat yourself. You really have to be sensitive.
You also taught me the naturopathic detox bath, which I have given out to many, many, many patients, and I've done hundreds of them myself. So describe, what is a naturopathic detoxification bath?
And I believe I learned that first from the late Dr. Scherer, who was the, you know, granddaddy of holistic health here in Santa Fe, New Mexico. And it's basically a pound of sea salt and a pound of baking soda to start. Now, that's a basic form.
Which is about a cup.
Yeah, it's about a cup. Or one of those little boxes kind of a thing if you're buying for the baking soda. But then others talk about Epsom salt because it has more magnesium in it. So, and then another one he did was pour a whole pint of hydrogen peroxide in a bath. I can't remember exactly what that's for. But there are many things that you can do, and then, you know, rinse afterwards perhaps. But these things are absorbed into your bloodstream. Remember, we all came out of a womb. You know, our first 9 months of development was immersed in water. So you almost can't drink too much water. And I never go anywhere without my water bottle. And so I'm drinking it constantly. And you want to drink more water most of the time and breathe well.
So a detox bath is a cup of salt.
The old naturopathic.
Cup of baking soda.
Sea salt and baking soda.
And a cup of Epsom salts is what I've been adding.
Okay, see, so this is the modern, you know, technique. So there's going to be improvements made all the time. And that's maybe where muscle testing might come in for you to find out what's best for you.
Mm-hmm.
What do you need at that time? And it changes. It's constantly changing, you know?
Yeah, yeah. No, I've added a number. And the hydrogen peroxide, if you put hydrogen peroxide on your skin, you'll find out where the dead cells are. Or the damaged cells. Like if you have a cut, it'll foam up. But if the skin's just moist and healthy, it'll just run off like water. So hydrogen peroxide is a really good debreeder.
Oh, yeah. And I remember
somebody
told me, and I've been doing it now ever since when I have my cutting board. I always, after I finish washing with soap and water, put a little hydrogen peroxide on it, and I hope it's safe at that point.
It's also, I've been doing a lot of foot baths with my father. My father does not like to take baths. I love them, so I'm a water baby. He's a not water baby. He loves the mountains, and so do I. But I've been doing a lot of foot baths with him, and he has toe fungus and some athlete's foot fungus in between the webbings. And a vinegar soak in a foot bath is a good preliminary, and then treatments on top of that. But I'll do a whole show on foot baths pretty soon.
No, yeah, we experiment with that. It's there's so many things out there. So remember, take yourself on as a hobby. You know, think of you as your own hobby. Take how to learn more about your body. As a former educator in the state of California, I left it because I didn't believe that the curriculum was doing the right thing. But you really need to know about the body. And if I was rewriting curriculum, I would start at the young age. You know, see Johnny run. His legs, you know, are moving, you know, his blood is pumping, his lungs are breathing. I mean, and so by the time they graduate from high school, they've all had the functional equivalent of anatomy and physiology and basic biochemistry and these other things and physics. I mean, come on. Why not teach that too with everything else? They've got to learn how. And physical now, education, more important than ever.
What, your father lost his hair at a young age, right? Went male pattern baldness. You decided to take that on as a project.
Well, I was in law school at the time, and I remember I was in my 20s, and I remember every time I was brushing my hair, the hair was coming out. I go, whoa. And then I read a case, a legal case, where a company in Nevada had discovered a product that cleaned the sebum buildup in the hair follicles out, and that was a major cause of male pattern baldness. And they had won a case against the post office, who had said, well, this is obviously some type of, you know, fake deal or fraud. Mm-hmm. And they won that case. Says, you know what, I'm going to at least do this. I'm going to at least try this product. And you can see I've got hair that I don't believe I would have had, because my dad had half the hair. My uncle was straight bald. His father was straight bald. And my mother's father was thin. but I have better hair than them. My brothers are doing okay on their own, but I have this hair now because I took those steps. So don't be afraid to try some things. You're going to make mistakes. Don't worry about the mistakes, then you correct them.
Well, you also are a wonderful exerciser, and that's such an important thing, is getting out in nature and moving.
Yeah, well, I when you say it, I go, ooh. I'm not doing as well as I could have in that score, but at the moment, you know, I'm right for this. I'm going to my Zumba class, you know, after this. But, you know, yeah, exercise is great. And what I like about Zumba is it's dance. It's aerobic dance. And so it's not just jumping jacks or something that's just exercise for exercise point. You're dancing. And that grace and the movement is part of it, you know.
And the music.
And the music, yeah. Music
moving
is great.
To the music, yeah. Well, that's one of the last doctor appointments I went to with my father. They emphasized, oh, it was actually an eye appointment. And he's got some troubles going in his retina. And the ophthalmologist in Santa Fe, who's just about to retire, said, water and walking. Those are two main things that you can do to help your retina heal. And he said, the two W's.
Yeah.
Everybody I go to says the two W's, walking and water.
I ski with her father into his 90s. He was a good example in that area.
Yeah, he has a lot of very good health habits, and I'm seeing the benefits of taking care of yourself. I mean, he's 97 years old, and he still drives safely. He's got great vision. He's got great hearing.
And that means he passes the DMV's test. So.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, I mean, I'm sure he's a much safer driver than a lot of young adults that are texting at the same time or listening to their music.
Please
or
don't do that. Please don't do that. It's epidemic. I know it is totally seductive. You have to stop doing it. It's not safe.
Another amazing habit you have, Bill, is your dedication to your spirituality and going to Mass. 5-6 times a week sometimes when you can.
I'm embarrassed to tell you, it's for the benefits. I go for the benefits. They're free, but they're just energizing for you. Your spiritual life is something largely misunderstood by many people, and you have to kind of trust. And again, that rational mind has to kind of be quiet for a while as you go forward. You ask yourself, who are you? What are you doing here? What is a human being? What is a human being? Now, in previous show, I mentioned I used to be an assistant autopsy surgeon, and I saw what's left of a human being. Well, when the soul and the spirit leaves the body, it dies. The body is dead. There's no more life. We've seen from time-lapse photography what's going to happen to it. It will disappear. Then you'll just have a skeletal structure there, which is wonderful. But the point is, you're alive.
There's actually a measurable weight difference after somebody dies.
Yeah.
And as a 5-year-old, I experienced my father's mother was a Christian Scientist, and she asked my parents to not take her to the hospital after she'd had a stroke. So my strongest memory of her is my father telling me that she had died, and he made it very natural and normal. And I remember just looking up at him thinking, oh, okay. And then he took me in to see her, and I could tell that was her body, but she was gone.
How did he describe it to you? Do you remember?
Just very, that it was okay, that she had died, and that he was going to show me that. And it just felt so normal, and I always really appreciated my parents giving me that experience.
Yeah, I bet their behavior was critical to that, just being gentle and matter of fact, and just stay in your heart.
Mm-hmm.
Stay in your heart and your soul as you're describing something with your mind.
Well, it was quite unusual in Los Alamos in 65 to have your grandmother die in your home. Mm-hmm. Most people died in the hospital in that part of the world.
Mm-hmm. We've had some great innovations with the late Kubler-Ross and Raymond Moody, and forgive me, the other modern people have built on their shoulders about life after life and that connection between death and transition. My dad is a doctor. He'd say, yes, they've joined the alumni. Right. I like that. That was my dad's way of describing that.
Well, the subject we're on now about dying and death has a lot to do with the motivation to take care of yourself. I mean, I've had patients come in and say, you know, they're in their 50s and 60s and they're just achy and feel awful. And it's like, I would have taken care of myself better if I'd known I was going to live this long.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a balancing act. And I just heard a talk that was given to the Santa Fe Institute for Spirituality when I first started with it 30 years ago. And this woman talked about how she got into exercise in her 50s. After, you know, I had a Roman Catholic bishop come here, the late William Gomes. He was the Bishop of Pune, India. And he was starting to feel kind of old and tired. And his young priest was saying, oh, Bishop, you should go see Iyengar. You know, Iyengar lived in Pune and him on as a student and taught him yoga.
Wow.
And then he came and taught yoga to us as a Roman Catholic bishop at a Catholic institution. And I remember the headlines. He's no guru, but he teaches yoga, Bishop Gomes. And it silenced a lot of people because he was right down the line with Rome. But this is, he just taught the asanas, the postures, the rest of it. And you have to move. Your body is the temple of your spirit. You need to maintain and take care of your body as a temple.
Oh, absolutely. I just took my father to a foot and ankle doctor, and the name of their business is In Motion. Mm. And I thought, that is perfect. Mm-hmm. When things stagnate, that's when disease happens, mm-hmm. and when depression happens, and when life starts stopping. So In Motion, and that's exactly what you're talking about. Well, we're coming to the end of this segment, and thank you so much for coming on and being my guest on the show that you inspired, New Mexico's Naturopathic Medical Show. I'm Dr. Wendy Van Dilla, Doctor of Naturopathic Medicine, and my host, Bill O'Donnell, and he's got his own show, Spirituality TV, which is, and you have many, many shows.
And you see it on YouTube.com. Yeah. Just go to Bill O'Donnell. Your time. I always tell him, think Rosie O'Donnell, my distant cousin. Strike the Rosie, put in a bill, and you'll find me there. No disrespect, Rosie. Haven't met you yet, so come on my show.
So thank you for watching, and New Mexico's Naturopathic Medical Shows are also on YouTube under Naturopathic Show, or you can go to nmshow.com. So you've got lots of good things to watch from a spiritual perspective and a health perspective.
It's the best health show on TV, in my opinion, and I'm prejudiced.
Thank you, Bill, and thank you for watching. Thank you, Harvey, and thank you, George.